a collaboration with a large team of researchers from LSE, UCL and the Centre for Economic Research in Pakistan. And the intervention is essentially motivated by the work that Robin described of evaluating the poor programme in Bangladesh. And whenever we presented that in front of academics, in front of policymakers, in front of the media, one question that always arose is, well, this is a very expensive programme. What would have happened if you gave the same households just an unconditional cash transfer of the same value instead? And so we were fortunate enough to find a partner in Pakistan, PPAF, who were implementing such unconditional cash transfers as well as in-kind asset transfers. And so this piece of research allows us to try to understand what is the difference if we provide social protection to the ultra-poor in the form of asset transfers as opposed to unconditional cash transfers. So it's essentially helping us to unpeel one layer of the broader debate in terms of what's the optimal way to design social protection for the ultra-poor. We know that there's an evidence base suggesting that in-kind asset transfers have permanent and large impacts on the lives of the ultra-poor. Robin described some of those results already. Ariana's going to be describing some of the long-term impacts in a later presentation. But similarly, there's also emerging evidence for the efficacy of unconditional cash transfers in developing country contexts. So the debate is very much alive, and no more so than in our particular empirical setting, which is Pakistan, where there's a nationwide system of unconditional cash transfers in place, BISP. That's also a setting in which asset transfers have been shown to be effective. So what we want to understand is, in that same economic environment, is there a difference in how the ultra-poor are able to respond to these two types of social protection programme? Of course, theory would suggest that if markets operate perfectly and individuals make decisions according to a standard neoclassical framework, then there should be no reason to provide transfers in kind. You can always do at least as well with unconditional cash transfers. However, there's good reasons to think that the world, especially the world faced by the ultra-poor, departs from that textbook reality. And so there's two classes of concern that might cause there to be differences in how households respond depending on the form of social protection provided. One is that there may be market imperfections that the poor face. So there may be costs that the poor face in actually accessing markets. Those access costs may relate to distance or time, or the availability of high quality services that are complementary to livelihoods. There may be other markets that are simply missing or imperfect. It may be that the poor are unable, with any given unconditional cash transfer, to purchase some information or purchase the relevant set of skills that would enable them to graduate out of poverty. And there may be other types of market imperfections, such as the possibility that other individuals may informally tax the poor and therefore reduce their incentives to engage in productive investment activities in the first place. There's a whole set of reasons related to those kinds of market imperfection that might cause there to be a wedge between how the poor respond to unconditional cash transfers versus transfers in kind. There's a second class of origins for a potential wedge between these types of social protection mechanisms, which essentially relate to behavioral economics and relate to how individuals make decisions, may be in some way related to the form in which social protection is provided. So there may be cognitive biases or various types of behavioral bias that cause individuals to respond differently when given cash as opposed to given an in-kind transfer. And so underneath the broad research agenda I'm going to describe, we'll be trying to, in the longer term, disentangle the relative importance of if there is a difference between the social protection given in-kind or as an unconditional cash transfer. How much of that difference originates from differences in how markets function across different locations, and how much of those differences are driven by behavioral or cognitive biases that the poor might have when faced with these two types of social protection scheme. I'll touch upon some evidence on that a little bit later. There are, of course, political differences that might relate to differences in choice in how we give social protection to the poor. It may be the case that non-beneficiaries are more likely to support in-kind transfers than unconditional cash transfers. There may be endorsement effects. There may be different costs of implementing these types of social protection schemes. So what we're trying to add in our particular evidence base is to understand, are there different benefits to the poor of actually receiving social protection in these different forms? And so how can we add that piece of the puzzle to understand the overall net impacts to society of providing social protection in one form rather than another? So we've been working with PPAF in four districts in southern Punjab to have a horse race between these two forms of social protection. So just to run through briefly some of the key elements of how this evaluation takes place, we have a listing of every household in each of the 100 villages or so in which the evaluation is taking place. Each household is assigned a poverty score between 0 and 100, and those households who are eligible to receive one form of social protection or another are those households with a poverty score between 0 and 18. So this corresponds very much to the ultra-poor households that have been previously described by Mushtaq and Robin in their presentations. It corresponds to about 30% of all households in the villages that we're targeting in southern Punjab. In those villages, we then conduct a market assessment exercise to understand what kinds of assets would be most productive to households residing in those locations. And then villages are randomly assigned into one of three groups. There's a control group in which it's business as usual, and then there's a second group, which is I'm going to refer to as the first treatment group, in which we implement an in-kind asset transfer program where households are offered a menu of assets from which they can choose a combination of assets up to a given value. And then there's a second treatment group which receives the same choice of assets, but there's one item that's added to the end of that list, which is that you can receive the equivalent value as an unconditional cash transfer. This is an example of one of the asset lists that was provided to one of our villages. So the form in which assets take can be livestock transfers, transfers related to retail, crop farming, or non-livestock production. So there's a range of potential assets that a household could choose from. They can choose a various combination from this price list up until the value of 50,000 rupees. And with each associated asset, there's an associated bundle of skills that are also provided to the household in order to combine skills and capital in order to change livelihoods. That's what happens in the first treatment group. In the second set of villages, we have exactly the same asset list that are provided, plus one additional item, which is to say you can choose the equivalent amount as an unconditional cash transfer, which you're then free to choose how you would decide to invest or consume that unconditional cash transfer. We've been in the field for a number of years. The results I'm going to show you are based on 1 year result. So the results I'm going to show are 1 year after the assets were first transferred to the households. So you should think of these as very short run impacts of both the transfers in kind as opposed to the transfers that were provided in the form of unconditional cash transfer. So I'm not going to be able to settle any arguments about what's the relative returns to each of these two types of asset types of social protection scheme, but it is going to suggest that some short-run differences in how households respond to these types of social protection. And at this point, I should thank DFID as well for funding the baseline survey, as well as PPAF for conducting the intervention. These are the districts in which we're operating, 4 districts in southern Punjab. The evaluation takes place in just over 100 villages. Randomization leads to these villages being identical before we intervened. That's true both for the villages as a whole and the ultra-poor households in each of these three groups of villages are identical at baseline. Any differences in their economic outcomes and social outcomes is purely attributable to the program that we implemented. So this is what actually happened in terms of the choices that households made in these two treatment groups. So in the first treatment group, where households were only offered the list of assets, about over 80% of households chose some form of livestock. So very similar to what we observed in Bangladesh. Livestock rearing is really the preserve of the middle and upper classes. The ultra poor are willing to engage in those types of activities if given the choice to do so. Very few households chose another form of asset transfer. In the second group of villages that were assigned the same list of assets, but were also provided the unconditional cash transfer as an option, the vast majority of households chose unconditional cash transfers. Okay. When given a choice between cash and assets in kind, most of the ultra poor would choose cash. So essentially, our evaluation will be a direct comparison between the provision of cash versus the provision of livestock assets. Now, at the time when the unconditional cash transfers were provided to households, we asked them, what do you intend to use these transfers for? And the vast majority did say they were going to put them to productive use. Over 3/4 of households said they would use them for some livestock-related activity. 14%, the second highest category, said they would use them for some non-livestock related productive activity. So they were almost going to replicate what occurred in the first treatment group when households took assets directly. Very few of them report using them for reasons that we hadn't provided on our initial asset list. It's not that these households had some other form of investment in mind that we hadn't provided on our market assessment, and that was the reason they were taking up the unconditional cash transfers. What did they actually do with them? Well, amongst the second group of households, about 46% of them ended up using the cash transfers for some form of livestock. When they purchased livestock, they seemed to purchase cows, for example, one out of five times. The value of cows that they purchased are quite similar between what they purchased with their own cash versus what we provided in kind. There are some differences in the heterogeneity of the value of assets that are bought, but on average, the value of assets that they're buying are quite similar in both branches. So what are the impacts on their livelihoods and their expenditures? I'm just going to run through these results. And so one thing that's different from Bangladesh is that these transfers were provided to households, not necessarily to women in those households. So in Pakistan, we're focusing much more on how husbands respond as well as how spouses respond and then what happens to the household overall. So I'll show you the labour market responses of husbands, of wives, in terms of what they're doing and the number of hours they're doing those activities for. So the top panel refers to, on the extensive margin, the types of activity that men are doing. The bottom panel refers to the types of activity that women are doing. And here, the blue bars refer to the in-kind asset transfer, and the red bars refer to the unconditional cash transfer. So what we observe is that for both men and women, there are significant reductions in being economically inactive. That both types of program encourage both men and women to start joining the labor force, to start engaging in productive activities, and moving away from a complete reliance on handouts from other individuals in the village. That impact is slightly larger for women than for men, and when assets are provided in kind, that the reduction in economic inactivity is even larger amongst women than if they're given unconditional cash transfers. The big movement for both men and women is in terms of livestock rearing, exactly as we found in Bangladesh, but we see the movements into livestock rearing are higher when assets are provided in kind than when an equivalent unconditional cash transfer is provided. That's true for how both men are changing their occupations and how women are changing their occupations. So providing assets in kind seems to reduce economic inactivity and increases movements into livestock rearing, and that's true to a greater extent when we provide assets than when we provide an equivalent unconditional cash transfer. In terms of the intensive margin, so this is the number of hours that are devoted to economic activities amongst men and amongst women, we see that hours responses are larger for both men and for women when transfers are provided in kind than when social assistance is provided as an unconditional cash transfer. For the household as a whole, on average they're working, both husbands and wives combined, they're working about 60 hours more a year after the assets are provided. At baseline, they were working about 250 hours per month. So that's about a 40% increase in their ability to earn income from the labour market. So we're expecting over the longer term to translate into big impacts in terms of their earnings and other outcomes that Oriana's going to talk about a little bit later in the context of Bangladesh. In terms of expenditures, here we see the pattern of expenditures in terms of food consumption, non-food consumption, the ability to save, investment in other types of business assets, investments in non-business assets, so household assets, and total expenditures. So on all of these expenditure margins, we see slightly larger increases when we provide unconditional cash transfers. Those seem to be used more for consumption, used more for savings, other forms of investment. But in terms of labour market outcomes, at least in the very short run, we see bigger impacts in terms of labour market and employment activities. So there are differences between the two forms of social assistance. Hopefully we'll be able to report back in a few years in terms of how those evolve over time. What we've seen, this is a figure that Oriana will show you from Bangladesh a little bit later, that we see an evolution of outcomes over 7 years in Bangladesh. We're just focusing on them the very first year in Pakistan. Do these programs have similar impacts across space and across households? So here, what I've shown you is the impacts in terms of employment hours per month at the household level for two types of villages, those which are very close to markets and those that are very far away from markets. So we see that when both types of social assistance are provided to households who reside in remote locations, so they don't have access to livestock markets, other types of markets that might be complementary to social assistance, we see the impacts on their livelihoods are much smaller. That's true when we provide assets in kind, that's also true when we provide assets in cash, although the reduction for cash in proportionate terms is larger than if we provide assets in kind. So there seems to be a key interaction between how distant you are away from markets and your ability to change your labour market activities as a result of the programme. And then we see the flip. If you reside very far away from the market, you actually increase your savings to a greater extent than if you reside quite close by to a market. So there are heterogeneous patterns both by where households reside and in terms of other household characteristics. And the final element that I just wanted to highlight is that what I've been focusing on so far is how the ultra-poor themselves respond. In our evaluation, we also have the ability to look at how what happens to the village economy as a whole, as we've also been tracking non-poor households to see how labour market opportunities for those households are impacted, as the very poorest households in the village economy have these opportunities through some form of social protection scheme.
Talking about tackling extreme poverty, and there's two types of people probably sitting here: researchers, academics, policy makers. And some of you, for some of you, it's research and academic, and for some of us, it's a mission in life. That's what we do, not for a job, but we do it as a mission. And I think I'm saying that with great humility. That for some of us, the purpose in life is this. We talk about extreme poverty, but I'm not very sure how many people in this room frankly have experienced extreme poverty. I doubt if there's any of us, and I certainly have not. Extreme poverty is extremely ugly. What does it mean when I say it's extremely ugly? What it means is when a mother cannot feed her child, it's extremely painful. I think when we're talking about cash versus asset, I really want to discuss this point. I'm not going to be a proponent for cash versus asset at any point. It definitely is a combination. That's how we're looking at it in Pakistan. But it is a very ugly situation, extreme poverty, because it's a nutritional problem. It's a food security problem. It's a question of not having an extra day to live for your child who you've given birth to. And I want to just bring home that concept in this building, far away from the remote villages where we work, where we spend our time. I spend half my time in my capital of Islamabad, but I spend the other half in my villages with my people. And it is a very ugly situation. Now, the world definitely recognizes this problem. There's SDGs, etc. Billions are spent on it. There's development economists, there's politicians together who discuss, who work, and who implement strategies. I think that's why we're sitting here. But in Pakistan, I just want to take you back to how it started. It's important to understand that journey. In 2008, the economic situation was a bit messy. There was a coalition government in place, and the current finance minister was the finance minister then, and the idea of this income support program came up. And then the coalition broke, and the other party took it forward as this. And at that point, the amount allocated was only what could be affordable at the time, about $0.4 billion. That was in 2008. In 2015, that amount has gone up, like Richard was saying, to $1.02 billion. And the reason really is not just a commitment by our government, our PMLN government, to social safety, to the cash transfer, but also because we as an economy have stabilized. And it's important to understand that when economies stabilize, there's more that is available for them. Now, I can go through the fact that the fiscal deficit has gone from 8.8 to 5.37, and the foreign exchange reserves have increased 20 billion, or the world has acknowledged us in terms of our ratings have improved. But what I really want to talk about is the fact that 90% of our budget of this budget is from our own funds, and only the rest of it is from donors like DFID, World Bank, and ADB. Most of it a large percentage, more than 90% of it, is spent on the unconditional cash transfer. Our job really is to provide that safety net. And this whole debate about cash versus asset, there's two elements to it. There's the research element, and then I want to discuss what I've seen with my own eyes. Both of them are important. Now, the impact evaluations in for BISC, at least, they clearly show that the quarterly stipend which is given is spent on consumption. I mean, the consumption expenditure has increased. And it's more food, it's basic nutritional value that the women are buying food for their children mostly. When the consumption expenditure is sufficient to decrease the poverty incidence among the beneficiaries. Now, the other impact that has happened as a result, which is very important, is that women have retained the decision-making power over the cash transfer. And that's 64% of women have that power of retaining, they decide what to do with the cash. That is massive women empowerment for us, for a country like ours. It has also reduced the rates of child labor, and it has improved child nutrition in terms of the girls between 0 to 5 years. That's the impact side of it. Now, what we have seen with our own eyes is it's a make or break. It's a life and death situation. It's a sustenance issue. It's a situation when you have the cash, you're able to keep yourself alive or not, and you're head over the water. I want to talk about why this is an exportable success story, a bit like BRAC was trying to, not brag, but BRAC certainly has you have full of opportunity and you're rightfully bragging about the story. Well, I'm not going to sit here and brag. What I do want to say is that we have certain USPs. Firstly, that we are a women-only program. There's not that many that in the world are women-only programs. The women only means that we have to give a CNIC, a national identity card, and the women need a national identity card for them to actually get that cash transfer. That means that once they get a national ID card, they have a right to vote. So you are politically empowering them because they can vote. You are financially empowering them because money is coming only to them, and you're of course socially empowering them. The second USP is our payment mechanism. We have learned over the years from 2008 to 2015, and we do this at a massive scale. We have 5.2 million to date beneficiaries, women, who are getting this in the entire country. And this payment mechanism has worked from postman. It started with the postman. It has moved on to ATM cards. It is now moving on to the final version, which is the biometric version, which is the safest. So they receive the cash through a biometric verification. The third is that we have a national socioeconomic registry. And that's something that we are extremely proud of. It's an objective way of targeting. It means that we're moving into a resurvey situation also. So we're the only ones in the country who actually know where the poor are located. And then other organizations who are sitting here can actually do research or can actually fund other asset-based projects to the same ultra-poor, if you like. The fourth is the fact that we have what we call BISC beneficiary committees. This is a women empowerment goldmine, I call it. Because these are committees that sit on a monthly basis and can discuss what their problems are. The idea really is to give them dignity, empowerment, and meaning to life. The fifth is equity. Equity meaning it's a federal government project which is run in the entire country. We have 4 provinces, 2 territories, and Pata. So we have 7 different areas in which this is running equally. It is important to see this in a fashion that it's a national program. It's not just a pilot which is being run in certain areas. And the sixth is that we're trying to bring corporate governance into the public sector, which to you sitting in London might not mean much, but to someone coming from Pakistan, it means a lot. We're trying to transform the entire way that the actual cash transfer works. Now I want to talk about the mix between cash and asset. We definitely believe that there needs to be a mix because you cannot just leave them. You can't take the cash away. You take the cash away, they drown in poverty. But if you just leave the cash, which is not enough to create a dependency, it's a very small amount, so there's no dependency creation. It's not like a global dependency. You do need a graduation strategy, and that's why we have partners sitting, and I'm very proud that we have some of them sitting on the stage right here. We are partnering with organizations which are public, which are private. And the government of Pakistan is spending a lot of money, not just on the cash side, but also on the asset side, also on the graduation strategy side. We have a program on education, which DFID is running with us, for us. We are going to touch 1 million mark. We're going to be at the 1 million enrollment for our children. So we are giving them a conditional cash transfer, extra money for sending their children to school, which takes them away from the child labor situation. That's a significant contribution, I think. Other than that, there's about 24,000 of our women, of our 5.2 for now. We're going to be encouraging this number to grow and grow because we want the graduation to work. Who are taking interest-free loans, called the Prime Minister Interest-Free Loan Program. And that is creating the real difference. That is creating the graduation. That is creating the breaking of the cycle of poverty. And that's the real challenge, to move in such a way that there's a balance between the two, but there's more and more moving out of the poverty cycles. And then we have an outreach program for the illiterate. We talked a little bit about illiterate. I don't think we talked a lot about illiterate. That is a real issue in these countries, the way you communicate to them. We have a communication strategy. Some of you might find it strange, but through street theater, through radio messages, through social mobilization, in women empowerment messages, family planning issues, polio messages, education on financial inclusion, education on productive inclusion, etc., etc. We are also working with philanthropic organizations. So public sector, for the graduation strategy, for them to bring them on, and with corporates, for their corporate social responsibility programs to be linked through us. So they use our database to get our women to graduate. We give the cash, but the graduation is done by our partners, if you like. As a single strategy, I think we're talking about the SDGs a lot. What I really want to suggest over here, and I want to leave it at that, is that we are open to solutions and we're open to learnings from other countries, but we're also in a position to learn, to share our experiences. And there are other countries coming to Pakistan and learning on the special cash transfer that we have managed to do in such a big way. We're talking about, with the World Bank, about creating a league of social safety nets. And this is something that I was discussing here as well. A part of that would be the academic side of it. So whatever your research says is very important to policymakers, to politicians, because yes, we do need that to back arguments in parliament, to be able to say yes, funding is going in X or Y and Z positions. There's a lot of us sitting in this room to whom this subject is critical for research, and there's some, like I said, for whom this is like a mission in life. And there's a few youngsters I see, a few students. I don't see that many of them, but I do see them. Hopefully they'll be there in the evening session more. My son is here, also is an undergrad at the LSC. I hope that this process will move on, and I hope that this process will move on towards not just a simple debate between cash versus asset, but as a combination of the two to keep this process going. Richard was talking about meeting the goal of eradication of poverty, 2030, etc. It's a lifelong process. It's not something that's going to end in 2030. For us, it's a lifelong process, and we, as Government of Pakistan, are committed to it. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. I hope I kept to my 10 minutes. I'm now going to go back and introduce the panelists, and I'm very glad that I'll be able to do so. So thank you.
I'd just like to actually share our experience in terms of how we developed this program, and where we are at now, and how this research will influence the work that we're planning on doing. We are a great believer in actually starting small, and then being a kind of a sector developer in the program, and then tweaking our program based on, because as you know, development is very contextual and needs to, and is very incremental. So that's how, what we did was, when we had this, what I would call a serendipitous meeting with BRAC gentleman, Mr. Hashmi, who I met about in the year 2008, and he told me about INGVID, or the acronym then, and I thought this was a great program, and let's do it. And sometimes we need some people who have, who take the leap of faith, and if we needed $1 million to do the research and do the asset, and we got actually the IFAD, International Fund for Agriculture Development, to put in that $1 million. And we selected two districts of coastal Sindh, which are particularly poor and exposed to all kinds of disasters, floods, cyclones, and the works. And as the results started coming out, we didn't wait for the final results, which had just been published in the Science and also been mentioned in the Economist. But when we saw the preliminary results coming out, we thought this was really fantastic and we need to do this big time. So we started with the 2,000 households in two districts and we followed the BRAC model to, you know, ditto. We said, you know, let's just follow it and try and replicate it. Then we developed what we call, and we saw the positive results, we developed a framework. So a kind of an ecosystem, because this is a fairly sophisticated program that you need to have support services as you go. Handholding the poor, nurturing the process, requires specialized institutions, specialized skills, you know, support at the village level. And this was the kind of framework we developed. Our fundamental investment for all our programs, let me just say that PPAF is a fairly large program and has two arms, two operational arms. One is we, in a way, we'd like to believe we created the microfinance sector in the year 2000. Pakistan didn't have a microfinance sector to speak of. 40,000 borrowers, three microfinance institutions. 2012-13, Economist rates Pakistan as the third best in the world in terms of microfinance. And 2012-2013, now that's quite an achievement. And now we have about 3.5 million borrowers, you know, 50 institutions. So how did this come about? This came about through a sector development approach. And the reason I'm mentioning this is because that is the approach we would like to take in this regard as well. This is something new. Create the institutions at both level, institutions for the poor, of which we work as an apex. We have 120 partners. That includes primarily civil society, increasingly research partners, increasingly corporate sector, and also working very, very closely with government. And we are extremely, you know, excited about this new partnership that we are going to embark on with this, inshallah. So the first investment that we do, and this is absolutely critical, is the investment in the institutions of the people. And that's, you know, helps in a lot of things. And Choli Saab was also mentioning that, you know, in terms of be it identification or the, you know, who should get the assets, because there is a lot of tension, there is a lot of inequities, there is a lot of people who don't have voices. So how do you decide who the asset goes to? And if some external agency is going to do it, it's going to create a lot of problems. And then we have to live with the repercussions of conflict that has been created. So giving a few assets to a few poor people, I think you have the kind of consensus that is built through community institutions, is very, very powerful. We use two instruments. One is the Robert Chambers approach, which is the doing the wealth ranking, and that's done by the communities themselves. And we're fortunate in Pakistan also to have an instrument called the Poverty Scorecard, which ranks, which is an asset-based instrument, and the poorer you are, you are lower on the number, and the more number you have, the more kind of the richer you are. So in terms of the BIS program, it is from 0 to 16.1. They get
16.17
to be precise. That is what the stipend is given to. So that is how the selection happens. And just to take you through that process, after that what we do is, because there is this, and you saw that in the Imran's thing, that a lot of people concentrate a lot of their, you know, they just want livestock. So this could have serious repercussions in terms of the environment, in terms of, you know, obviously market saturation, all of those kind of things. So what we do is we've now started to say that you need to have a kind of a union council is the lowest tier of government. So what we do is we aggregate the people to that level. So aggregate empowerment comes through aggregation of the voices. So we are aggregating from a hamlet to a village to the union council. So if government cannot reach the people will actually reach the government. And that's the theory, and not only public sector, but private sector as well. So develop a plan for the union council, which is approximately about 3,500 households in Pakistan. At the individual level, once the household is selected, what we do is then develop individual household investment plans. Do cash flows. I mean, this is a fairly sophisticated exercise. You don't want to give money or assets to people then actually who cannot use them or who will go and sell them. And that was a good finding that we saw, that a lot of those assets were in fact retained. And this ensures, and we believe that training is an essential part of this. So from the 2,000, we have now gone to approximately 80,000 households. They're not all women. They're like half of them are women and half of them are men. But what we need, the creation of the ecosystem, that we are also very conscious of costs. We are also conscious of creating sort of resource people at the community level. So what we do is the skill development, and we have a cascade model in terms of training communities. We call them CRPs, community resource people, be it accountants or livestock extension workers or whatever. Create a cadre of them that they can be paid by the communities to actually go and, you know, inoculate their animals or give them some basic management training. That is an essential part of it. And again, also, what we've done is creating other kinds of community institutions, and you'll see the grays there, which are the youth center, the production centers, the loan centers, the what Naukriya Karobar means, you know, self-employment or employment centers. And these are very low-cost community, and we've rolled out about between 80 and 100 in a lot of the districts. And these are early days. So what we're saying, these are manned by the communities themselves. We low-cost model, we only provide training to them in terms of, so one of them is a kind of a matchmaking employment center. The loan center, which the minister was talking about, is basically we feel that the Prime Minister interest-free loan scheme, which is also being implemented by PPAF, we believe that even when you give a 20,000 rupee loan, which is what, you know, less than $200, you need to be give people skills, because otherwise you are in the danger of indebting them. So basically, this is the kind of the ecosystem that is required. We are constantly, and that's why research for us is so important. That's why we, you know, I think that $1 million investment that we did in 2009, okay, I see your hand, it was actually, I think, you know, has had huge payoff, because this was something that, my last comment, this was something that we've been always trying to, you know, convince governments on, to invest in this, convince donors of to invest in this, but it didn't really gain the kind of traction until the research started coming out. And then people started, you know, taking notice, and I got a call from the minister saying, you know, just read this in The Economist. So I think this is fantastic. And now it's coming together. There is evidence that poverty can be reduced or, you know, eradicated. And there are processes. So it's not sort of a pipe dream. There is processes. You need to follow those processes. And I think donor agencies need to also now look at what is the evidence, you know, their interventions. Where is the evidence to ensure that? And I think one final point is, I think they also need to, we, practitioners, researchers, donors also, need to have the kind of the courage to take risks, to not have sort of kind of frameworks which are not flexible. Because as we go along, and this is the learning that I'm really excited about, what the work that Imran and his team has done, is because now it gives us many options, and we want to, because like I said, development is so contextual, we need to be able to do mid-course correction. And this is development. Development, there is no blueprint. So you need to have a flexibility, agility, that you can respond to the various challenges that are. Poverty is not homogeneous, poverty is very unique, it's geographical, it's within households, it's within villages, Pakistan, and the world is now suffering a lot from regional inequalities. So, I see you. I stop.
Okay, thank you very much, Qazi.
In Uganda, we have a number of these programs, cash and assets. To start off, we have a cash transfer program, which to an extent has been deemed to be successful. The biggest question, however, is coverage. How far can we go in terms of scaling up this program to reach as many people as we should, especially the extreme poor? And that's where I begin, with the context and circumstances that we face when we are considering whether we should actually undertake a particular program or not, at least from the public sector perspective. Now, looking at the cash transfer program we have at the moment, you say it targets particular people who we deem vulnerable and unable to help themselves. These are mainly the elderly over 65 years of age, those with ELs, orphans, etc. Now, when you look at the circumstances we have in Uganda, we also have a very big informal sector, which has basically full of youth, the young and those who are unemployed. And the question is, should we focus on the youth, in which case we'd probably look at the asset side, because these would probably be able to sustain themselves after the initial introduction. Or should we target the old? That is really the question the minister has raised. The beneficiaries of the program matter to us when we are making a decision on whether actually the program should be undertaken or not. The other point is about the administrative cost, the administrative cost efficiency and the institutional capacity requirements for these programs. If you look at some of these asset programs, wonder what kind of institutional capacity requirements we would need within government to undertake and expand some of these programs, and let alone the possible interference. I saw in one of the programs, the political support that was demonstrated in the program here also has some other negative implications, because they look at the advantage they would get in terms of political capital. And for that reason, they interfere with the asset programs. And that's an experience we have had. At the end of the day, you end up targeting the wrong people, actually. You don't get the vision for. Now, of course, in these exercises, I mean, the evaluations that we pay, particularly targeting wrong people, perfectly target and get these households that we need to look at. For the cash transfer programs, we have been a little bit more successful because of the new technologies that we have now. We use mobile money, so you can actually get to the actual poor household, and you can target those, and you can make a transfer, and the political interference is somewhat minimized. But for the asset programs, because of their nature, it becomes very difficult to ensure that you avoid this political interference. Of course, our chair here is a minister. In many cases, they sort of interfere in this. So as we do this kind of research, you have to look at how do you ensure that when we want to scale up these programs, we can avoid these pitfalls. Mm-hmm. And of course, given that I'm from Minister of Finance, the issue that we have to look at is fiscal sustainability of these programs. For the asset program, of course, because of its very nature, it's a lot more appealing to us, because you know that you do it and then people can now graduate and move on to being able to sustain themselves. So you don't have to go back to them. But at the same time, the initial costs, right? I mean, what you have to do from the one goal seems significant, because you have to deal with the capacity, skills, development, et cetera, et cetera. So, and of course, the capacity requirements that I talked about within the institutions to undertake these programs. So those are the kind of issues one would have to take into account before we can actually take up these programs. Of course, there are some other considerations about the impact on the economic and social incentives, the local markets, do they exist, the social services. One of the issues that we have really faced is, okay, we want to introduce these programs, but for example, I wonder whether in Pakistan they haven't faced a situation whereby people can actually use these assets but then fail to get any market for their products. I don't know. But in our case, we introduced a vanilla program. At that time, the vanilla price of the world market was quite good. So government tried to promote this program. But then when it came to the output, the world price had fallen, the buyers were no longer there, and there was frustration. So we have not had very good experience in terms of some of these programs, and of course, what I have to talk about is
okay, thank you very much.
I'll try to chip into this discussion of cash versus assets from a recent study that we have completed in collaboration with CGAP and Professor Martin Vlies, who advised in that project too. But before going into that particular research findings, I think when we are talking about cash versus assets, it's a continuum, and you're absolutely right. I mean, it's always a mix. The graduation has the cash element in terms of subsidy. There are also like cash for assets. WFP is doing quite a bit of programming where they provide cash to purchase assets. Where do you put it? Is it cash or asset? But I think the question that Imran was putting is also quite real. We have this graduation model which has been tested, and the proof of concept is there. In these 7 or 8 settings, we know that this program worked. In one particular setting, it didn't work, and we also have a good understanding why it didn't work. On the cost side, is it really the whole package of this graduation model that's needed, or can we do only with the assets? From that perspective, it's not just theoretical question to ask what happens if you put you have this $500 per beneficiary, and you take this and maybe you spend $20 for targeting and for mobile transfers you have mentioned, and the rest $480 you just do the cash dump and see what happens. And it's not theoretical, and I think based on the evidence by Give Directly, it's they are actually doing it, and it's quite large scale now in Kenya and Uganda. In my reading, that has fueled this discussion of the debate quite a bit. From that perspective, this sort of evaluation is what exactly we need to answer this question. Going back to the meta-analysis that I've been doing with SIGAP and other colleagues, what we essentially did is we have these 7 cases for graduation programs, and we tried to look into the literature of unconditional cash transfers. And by unconditional, it means unconditional lump sum one-off cash transfer. It's not sort of stipends, but you want to compare as similar an intervention as possible. So there are 11 such unconditional cash transfer programs that we found. I can summarize the results in 3 sentences. First of all, out of these 11, half the times you find statistically significant positive results, half the time you don't. Well, to be precise, 6 of the cases you find positive results, 5 you don't. The second is, considering the statistical precision and the sample size of these each individual cases, if you do a meta-analysis, the average effect that you find on consumption per dollar spent is about 3 times higher than graduation. So that puts cash a little bit forward again. Now, on the third sentence of this summary would be, out of these 11 cases, only 3 target the extreme poor. The rest are kind of targeting the micro enterprises, essentially trying to address the sort of credit constraint, or sort of test the credit constraint faced by these micro enterprises. Now, if you look at these 3 versus these 7, you see the largest effect happens when these cash transfers target the micro entrepreneurs who already have a business operating, which again makes sense. From this analysis, there is not a clear policy conclusion. If I am a policymaker trying to invest in 20 different projects, and if I am happy to take the risk of, it will fail half the times, other half will work, but on average I'll have probably a higher social return, I'll probably go with cash. But if I want to make a bigger dent for extreme poverty, we need more evidence. And the more evidence that we need is precisely what Imran was presenting, where we put these 2 models next to each other and test them in the same setting. There are a few coming up. This is one, there's another one in Ghana. But we need a few more of those before we can have a sort of generalized conclusion on this particular debate. So from that perspective, I again sort of congratulate the team on doing this study, and we are of course sort of eagerly looking forward to the long-term results. But in the interim, it seems like the debate is probably going to continue for a while.
Okay, thank you very much.
Anne Hastings, and I'm with Amplifier Strategies and Uplift. On your study, Imran, are you comparing asset transfer within the context of a graduation program, or is it just giving the assets and then leaving? Because it seems that's the critical component, is are they getting the other benefits that they would normally get from the graduation program or not?
The asset transfers take place within a standard graduation program, so there's also skills support and social mobilization takes place within this community. So it's very much the same model that we've been describing in Bangladesh, and so that's why it's a very important comparison to start with.
I'm Karen Levy from Evidence Action. I was interested in the finding that you had, Imran, on the difference of impact in places near and far from markets, and whether or not people didn't express an intention to migrate when you asked up front, if this was perhaps an effect that you found ex post, and was there any difference between places near or far from markets?
So we do find an impact on migration. We find that households who receive either type of social protection mechanism are less likely to migrate than households in the control community, although there isn't a difference between the two types of treatment. So providing social protection does seem to enable people to stay in the same locations rather than migrate elsewhere. I don't have the results split by remote or distant locations, but you'd imagine that the impacts would probably vary along that dimension. So.
It just as a quick follow-up question, and you know, thinking about the work done by Munshi Mubarak in northwest Bangladesh on seasonal migration, you know, might that be an interesting combination if you find that a similar level of investment is less effective when you're far from the market? Can you see, based on your work, seasonal migration being complementary to some of these other approaches?
So I think we're at a stage where there's lots of potential policies that, you know, there's now a body of evidence for suggesting that they might be effective in some circumstances, whether it's, you know, enabling people to migrate, enabling people to, you know, to change livelihoods, or to actually just use the markets that they have access to. But that's why I think it's so critical to try to embed these all within a similar type of framework. And as Munshi said, I mean, I don't think this discussion is ever going to be resolved, because it's always going to be the case that the answers are fairly nuanced. It depends. And so what we'd really like to know is, what does it depend on? And so we can feed that into designing programs, you know, properly, really from the outset. And so, as Qazi Saab said, it's really a process of continual learning from every evaluation that we have to try to understand, why did it work, why did it not work in certain circumstances, you know, and then reallocate resources on the basis of that. Because we can't do everything, but we need the evidence base in order to be able to make sensible decisions from the outset.
And as Chair, I just want to add that the world is looking at now, especially at the South side, there was a South-South summit in Beijing funded by the World Bank, and we're talking about migration. The focus is now moving on the urban side also. So there's no real experience that any of the countries have. So we're learning from each other, and we're learning fast on how this whole concept of rural to urban will happen. For example, Pakistan is 87-13 from the last census, but peri-urban, etc. It's going to be a new debate. It's going to be new evidences. The researchers will be kept busy. The policymakers and politicians are now specifically looking at those kind of issues.
What are the attractions potentially for governments in incorporating graduation into their social protection programming is the fact that graduation will occur and that there will not be long-term dependence on resource transfers from the state. I know this has been an issue in Ethiopia, where there has been some debate about the extent to which graduates are indeed graduated in sustainable economic terms. Could you tell us, from Islamabad perspective, how you are interpreting graduation criteria, and whether one of the attractions of graduation is the potential longer-term resource saving to the state?
Parliaments and politicians love graduation. It takes us away from the putting a large amount on the cash stipend. So yes, we are investing in looking at other organizations who are experts at doing this. So we're trying to find experts, expert organizations to collaborate with, because Parliament is asking this question all the time. How fast are you going to graduate them out? There cannot be a dependency forever. But of course, there's natural disasters, there's calamities, etc. So this question will never really, like Sulaiman said, finish off. But from a political perspective, there's a big emphasis and on the graduation. And we're very lucky in Pakistan that we've got those institutions set up already. And it's a philanthropic society. So we can count on public and private sector to be able to manage that graduation soon enough, I think.